for this second Sunday in Lent is taken from St. Paul's first letter to Thessalonians, chapter 4. Brethren, we pray and beseech you in the Lord Jesus that as you have received of us and how you ought to walk and to please God, so also you would walk, that you may abound the more. For you know what precepts I have given to you by the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the passion of lust, like those Gentiles that know not God, and that no man overreach, nor deceive his brother in business, because the Lord, in the avenger of all these things, as we have told you before, and have testified, for God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto sanctification in Christ Jesus our Lord. And in the Gospel, taking that according to St. Matthew, chapter 17. At that time Jesus took Peter and James and John his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart. And he was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his garments became white as snow. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elias talking with him. And Peter answering said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. And as he was yet speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and lo, a voice out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him. And the disciples, hearing, fell upon their face, and were very much afraid. And Jesus came and touched them, and said to them, Arise and fear not. And they, lifting up their eyes, saw no one, but only Jesus. And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man, till the Son of Man be risen from the dead. Thus were the words of today's Holy Gospel. So, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Amen. Here in the second Sunday in the season of Lent, we bring up, it's in this time of Lent, not in the time of Easter, or in the time of Christmas, or in the time of Pentecost, but rather only in the time of Lent that we bring up the miracle of the Transfiguration. The Lord Jesus Christ showed his glory before his apostles, and then he told them that his Transfiguration, remember that's our Lord Jesus Christ went to the top of the mountain with Peter, James, and John, the chosen apostles, and the first one to be the head of the apostles, the first one to be the first beloved of the apostles, and the first one to be martyred. So St. Peter, of course, the head of the apostles, St. John, the first beloved, and then St. James, the first of the 12 apostles to die the death of a saint and martyr. And then he brought these first ones up to the top of the mountain, and then before them alone he showed Moses and Elias, and he spoke with them. So they saw Moses and Elias, they spoke with them. They saw him in his magnificent beauty. And then he said, tell the vision to no man, until the Son of Man rise from the dead. And so I say that we say, tell this vision to no man until the Son of Man rise from the dead. One would think that the miracle of Transfiguration will be a very good thing to tell people in order to spread the faith. And we say that not only does this man cure the sick and raise the dead, but this man, we saw him in magnificent glory. We saw him with our own eyes, and we heard him with our own voice speaking with Moses and speaking with Elias. Surely you must believe in Jesus Christ, because he was transfigured, and he was shown his magnificent beauty before his apostles, and he could have also shown this transfiguration before all men. He could have easily transfigured himself and shown his magnificent beauty. One thing that St. Thomas Aquinas emphasizes and St. Augustine emphasizes is that when our Lord Jesus Christ was transfigured before his apostles, there was no miracle. All he did was remove the veil of his normal magnificent beauty so that he could now be seen as he was in his normal human flesh. So if our Lord Jesus Christ walked the earth without performing any miracles, he just showed himself as he naturally was, he would appear in the magnificent glory of the Transfiguration. That's the normal state of Jesus Christ's body. But because we cannot bear this, as was made it clear in the prophecy of the Old Testament, when Moses went before God, and he had been in the presence of God, Then he came out of the presence of God, and just the reflection of the presence of God made Moses shine a bright light. Like it was like a light bulb, a light was coming out from his body, and there was a magnificent beauty in the face and body of Moses, so that people could not look at him directly. And hence, he had to put on a skin, he had to put on a helmet of a skin over his head, and so that Moses was asked to do this by the people because of the magnificence of his body, just being seen the reflection of Christ, the reflection of God. So the Transfiguration is not one of the miracles of Jesus Christ. He did perform many miracles, but the Transfiguration is not one of them. When he went up to the top of the mountain, he showed himself in his natural glory and his natural beauty of what happens to a human body when it becomes hypostatically united to God the Son. And when this happens, it becomes a magnificent beauty, and that no one can imagine or compare any other beauty of a human being to, or anything else created by God. Then we consider what Moses, what St. Peter, James, and John saw in the humanity of Jesus Christ. They saw the most beautiful creature ever created by God, which is the human body of Jesus Christ. And so that, and then they saw that man speaking with Moses and Elias in a way they had not heard him speak before. And it was so wonderful what they saw. And then they said, therefore they said, this is so wonderful. They then said, well, it is good for us to be here. Let's build a tent for you, a tent for Moses, and a tent for Elias. That's what St. Peter said. And then the vision disappeared. And they were so filled with joy and such beauty of this vision that the first thing they wanted to do was tell everyone about it. But our Lord Jesus Christ put a damper upon their desires, and he told them in the most strict manner, you will tell this vision to no man until the Son of Man rises from the dead. Now, why is this? Why is it that our Lord Jesus Christ would not allow his vision, the vision of his magnificent beauty, to be told by the apostles? Because surely it would bring about many conversions. Every wise man would sigh, any wise normal man would say, knowing about the Transfiguration, would cause many people to become believers of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yet he did not allow it to happen until after the crucifixion. And so therefore, what is the purpose of the Transfiguration? What is its value? Why did he do it? He did it for the sake of Peter, James, and John. It was not beneficial for the others. It was beneficial for them. But even they could not understand it, because he knew that when Holy Thursday would come, they would fail. They would fail. Therefore, the Transfiguration would not benefit Peter, James, and John right now. But later on, after the resurrection, they would finally understand the Transfiguration. They would not understand it until they had seen Jesus Christ transfigured upon the cross. When they saw that, and when they saw Jesus Christ die, and when they saw him rise from the dead, and they saw his flesh after the resurrection, so similar to his flesh when they saw it on top of the mountain, and that they saw it was the same Jesus Christ that was risen from the dead, that was the one that was transfigured on the mountain, only he was even more beautiful than he was then, that the apostles would finally understand the Transfiguration. The Transfiguration is a great miracle which God gave to Peter, James, and John, and which he will always give to the saints who are going to be martyred, to the saints that are going to have to suffer for our Lord Jesus Christ. That if you grow in the knowledge and love of God, we are supposed to grow in the knowledge and love of God, and then suffer whatever pains come our way during life, and then experience death, and then go to heaven. But our Lord Jesus Christ demonstrates by the Transfiguration that there is such a thing in the supernatural life called consolation. And God will give consolation to his saints. While we all count our desolations, and we all count our difficulties, and we all count our problems, God will always give a transfiguration to the vision of the Transfiguration to his saints. There will always be, to those that are going to die pleasing to God, some kind of understanding and vision of the beauty of the next life. Remember that St. Paul, what did God say about St. Paul when he spoke to Ananias? Ananias, Saul of Tarsus is blind, and Saul of Tarsus must be cured, and you must go and cure him. Is not this the one that persecuted the church of God? Yes, but he is a vessel of election. He is a special vessel of election chosen by me, and I must teach him what he must suffer in my name. That's what he told Ananias.
so that St. Paul will suffer more than the martyrs, and St. Paul will suffer more than many, many of the other great saints. But he's a vessel of election. But what does St. Paul say? He did travel through a life of great suffering, not just the physical suffering of being thrown in the sea and scourged multiple times, etc., but all the moral sufferings of the difficulties he received by the attacks of the enemies of God. But then our Lord said, St. Paul said, I know a man 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body, I know not, God knows, that such a one was taken up into the third heaven to see things forbidden for man to see, to hear things forbidden for man to hear. And what does that tell us? That St. Paul saw something more beautiful than to Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration. They saw Christ in a greater beauty than either Peter, James, and John. Peter, James, and John walked with Christ at the top of a physical mountain. On the top of that mountain, they saw Christ transfigured. But St. Paul was pulled into the air. He levitated, as many saints would levitate after him. But he was pulled up into the air. He was pulled physically into the clouds. He was brought high into the sky. And there he saw things forbidden for a man to see. He was elevated above all the earth to see magnificent visions. And what do these visions do? They comforted him. Also, St. Augustine says, even our Lord Jesus Christ allowed these things to happen in his own life to remind us human beings that while God will allow us to suffer, he will allow us to be hated, he will allow us to experience sickness, he will allow us to experience all manner of pain in this life, those that are his friends. He always mitigates with a consolation. He always does. Our Lord Jesus Christ, for 40 days and 40 nights, fasted in the desert. At the end of the desert, Satan came and tempted him. And Satan said, turn these loaves into bread. And St. Augustine points out, he did not turn the loaves into bread. He remained hungry. And he used the sacred scripture and the teaching of the Old Testament to destroy the wickedness of Satan. He then said, begone, Satan. Now he had two problems. One, he was hungry from 40 days of fasting. And two, he was exhausted from a fight with the devil. He was thoroughly exhausted in his humanity from a great battle with the devil. And he had to walk all the way back to the city and all the way back to the civilization to get food and rest. God did not allow this to happen. Angels came down from heaven, and they ministered to him. And St. Augustine says, when they ministered to him, what it means is they set a table in the desert, and they adorned the table with cloth, and they put food upon the table. And it was way better than the bread would have been had he turned the loaves into bread. And he ate a sumptuous feast. The angels fed him a physical feast. He ate food. He ate meat. He ate a wonderful meal that was very well cooked. He didn't eat garbage food. He didn't eat junk food. He ate magnificent food prepared by the angels, physical food that his human flesh needed. And fully strengthened and fully recovered by this great feast, he walked back into the city and began his public ministry. So that our Lord gave and ministered to him. It also says at the end of the Agony in the Garden, there was a ministering to him. So that there was some kind of consolation from the angels before he, in that brief period, before he went from the battle of the 3 hours of the agony to the battle of the cross, that even in that great sorrow, he received comfort. And as he traveled through the crucifixion, the holy women, St. Veronica would wipe his face. St. Simon would carry the cross behind our Lord. And St. John, even though he was weak, would at least be there standing next to the Holy Mother, and the Blessed Mother will be with him until the end. And each of these things are consolations for human hearts. He was abandoned by all men, but he said, even though he was abandoned by all men, even he said, I go to this battle alone. Jesus Christ, in his battle on the cross, was never completely alone. God will never allow human flesh that loves him, he will never allow a human heart that loves him to be ever completely and totally abandoned. There the Blessed Virgin Mary stood at the foot of the cross. There was St. John. And that consolation, which we are not to seek in this life, but consolation does not need to be sought. And the reason for that is, what did our Lord say? The lilies of the field neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. And as St. Teresa of Avila said, not only the lilies and the grass not gather into barns, They don't even look for rain. They don't even look for soil. They don't even look for nutrition. They just live. And nutrition comes to them, and rain comes to them, and warmth comes to them, and they are cared for, and they continue until the ending of the world. The grass never goes extinct, and yet the grass never works for its own salvation. God provides for it. And then our Lord himself said, on the Sermon on the Mount, the lilies of the field neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, but your heavenly Father watches over each one of them. Are not you of much more value than they? So if it is true that we have the love of God in our hearts, and we go after God with our minds, and we go after God with our bodies, and we run into many difficulties, as the martyrs have run into down the last 2,000 years of the Catholic Church, and in fact the whole 6,000 years of our history of being followers of God, there have always been martyrs. And what is it that makes them so strong? What is it that makes them so happy? The vision of the joy that they will find. St. Thomas Aquinas points out, no man can rejoice because he's hit. No man can rejoice because he's been nailed to a cross. And Jesus Christ was a man. He did not rejoice that he was nailed. He did not rejoice that he was scourged. He rejoiced at the benefit that would come from the nailing. And the great benefit was twofold. He would benefit because, number one, he would receive the nails so that we would not receive the nails. He would protect us from the nails. And he would benefit because he would make reparation for the nails that we deserved, and therefore be able to carry us as treasures into the kingdom of heaven. So he protects us from pain, therefore he rejoices in pain. And he brings us to as a treasure to his Father, therefore he rejoices in the treasure. He does not rejoice in the pain, he rejoices in the protection of us from his pain, and he rejoices in the reward of carrying us to his Father. And for human beings outside of Jesus Christ, we have a third reason to rejoice. And that is, we get a reward also. So that we can receive pain in order to protect others from pain. And we can receive pain in order to suffer for them so that they might be dragged into the kingdom of heaven, save their souls. And when we receive pain, we get our own reward. And therefore, there are three reasons for us to rejoice and two reasons for Christ to rejoice. And so the fact is that there are reasons to rejoice in pain. Now, it is not natural for us to rejoice in pain. And it is not possible for us to do it using only our natural reason and even our understanding that good is going to come from it. Therefore, God gives us a supernatural gift to help us to rejoice in pain. And this will be the consolation of the saints. He will give a supernatural gift. He will also teach us what happens. So that Saint Stephen, the first martyr, what happened to him before he went to his martyrdom? He also, right before he was stoned to death, he looked up into heaven and he saw the glory and the beauty of God. And he saw a vision of the magnificence of heaven. And that magnificence was so wonderful, the little things like stones coming to hit him did not bother him at all. And what filled his heart at the time that he was being stoned to death was, Lord, lay not this sin up to their charge. Now, what makes it possible for him to do this? The wonder and the beauty of God, and the wonder and the beauty of his creation, and the wonder and beauty of his goodness and love that we can see by miracles like unto the Transfiguration. Peter, James, and John were not yet St. Peter, St. James, and St. John. They were just Peter, James, and John. And therefore, Lord Jesus Christ told him, you don't tell this vision to anyone. The last thing I want to hear is you telling how beautiful that things were on top of the mountain. I don't want to hear your explanation of Elias, because Elias is going to come personally to break your neck. I don't want to hear your explanation of Moses. I don't want to hear your explanation of me, because it will all be wrong. But after you weep, and after you experience the sorrow of Good Friday, and after your hearts have been broken, and after you recognize how weak you are because you run away as cowards, and after you realize that the only way you can be my disciple is you have total confidence in me and not in yourselves, and after the victory of the resurrection, when you see what this transfiguration really means, then go and tell the world about the transfiguration. Then go and speak of the miracles, the consolation of the saints. Then go and show the world what is the beauty of being with Christ and the beauty of the cross. But you can't understand that beauty. You can't understand that good until you have experienced the pain yourself. And hence it is in the supernatural life. God will make sure that as we travel through the sorrows of life, there will be consolations. And also the saints tell us, if there are no consolations ever, and this is actually not true because everyone gets consolations, but because we so easily forget them, but if we feel there are no consolations ever, then we must test our consciences and test our souls. Because while we are experiencing agony, if we are too sad, if we are too sorrowful, remember there's something wrong. That's why St. Paul says, children, when your father has died, your mother has died, your wife has died, your children have died, and so on, whoever has died, do not have sorrow as those who have no hope. Yet he doesn't say don't have sorrow. St. Paul does not say don't have sorrow. He said don't have sorrow as those who have no hope. For there is a sorrow that is with hope, and there is a sorrow without hope. And the sorrow without hope is of the devil. And the sorrow with hope is of God. And the sorrow with hope, where does the hope come from? It comes from the realization of the victory of the martyrs. Remember the victory of the martyrs. In fact, when the bishop now puts on the pectoral cross, he says a prayer, put it on the pectoral cross. He says, remember this cross. And in this, keep the cross always before your breast. And keep the memory of the saints, because inside the pectoral cross is a saint of martyrs. And remember the saints enclosed in this cross. And remember the victory of the martyrs. Remember the victory of the martyrs. That we must carry the cross before us. But what are we supposed to think of when we think of the cross? Victory. The cross is the victory of martyrs, the victory of St. Stephen, the victory of all the apostles that died martyrs, and St. John is counted as a martyr, though he was not able to physically die as one. The victory of all the saints of the last 2,000 years, and including the confessors, they die martyrs of divine charity. Consider the victory of the martyrs, that when they suffered, they brought about the salvation of souls, they brought about the reparation of sin, and they accrued to themselves a great glory in heaven, and these are three reasons to be happy. There's only one reason to be sorrowful. It hurts. There are three reasons to be happy because of the great rewards. And there is a fourth one, which is the pain shall end. The pain shall end. And so that the pain of those who love God ends, and it ends forever. And the three rewards remain forever. And therefore, it isn't reasonable for us, who are the followers of Christ, to weep too much, to sorrow too much over agony and pain. And hence the church has wisely chosen that the Transfiguration, this great wonderful miracle of the life of Christ, should not be put in the Christmas season or the Easter season or the Pentecost season, but right here at the beginning of Lent. Because what did our Lord say to his apostles, Peter, James, and John? You are not yet St. Peter. You are not yet St. James. You are not yet St. John. You will be St. Peter. You will be the rock that I put up, that I build my church upon, but not yet. You will be my most beloved disciple who will write the most divine gospel, but you're not St. John yet. And you will be the first one to die and shed your blood in my name of all my 12 closest followers, but you're not St. James yet. Therefore, you don't know about this Transfiguration. You have seen it, but you do not understand. And this is also an example of against the enemies of the church. Many enemies of the church say, our Lord Jesus Christ said on Holy Thursday night, I have many things to tell you, but you cannot bear them now. Well, and yet the church teaches that Jesus Christ taught everything before he died. Isn't that a contradiction? He did teach everything before he died. And one thing that he taught was the Transfiguration. But they could not understand it yet. And later on, they would speak of the Transfiguration. And this Transfiguration they had already seen before. Jesus Christ already spoke to them about the meaning of the Transfiguration before, but they could not understand. And therefore the Holy Ghost would speak the same words that Jesus Christ spoke to them, but in a way that they could understand. Hence, there is no contradiction between our Lord's teaching that there will be no new teaching after the death of the Christ and the death of the last apostle. And yet, there are many things to tell you, but you cannot bear them now. And one example of this is Holy Feast of the Transfiguration. And so the Transfiguration cannot be understood without the cross. And the Transfiguration and consolations of the supernatural life are the means to get through the crosses of life. And of course, I God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.